Hello and welcome to Family Matters, a joint production between the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family and the University of the District of Columbia. I'm Dr. Roberta Holt from the Bowen Center, your host of Family Matters. In this television series, we want to provide ideas that can be useful to you as you think about your own relationships and the families in which you are a part. Today's program is part two on our discussion about addictions and addictive behavior from a family systems perspective. Again, my guest is Joan Jurkowski. Joan has spent her professional career working with people with an addiction. She's from the Baltimore area and is respected by her peers as a counselor, teacher, and researcher in addictions. She has a master's degree in counseling psychology, is certified as a licensed clinical professional counselor, and as a certified associate counselor in alcohol and drugs. In addition, she completed 5 years of training in family systems at the Bowen Center. Joan, welcome to this edition of Family Matters. I wanted to have you back because you had published in their family systems journal here a research study that you completed when you were working for, was it the city of Baltimore?
It was a private nonprofit organization in Baltimore City.
Okay. And you had completed a research study there, and I thought it was interesting enough that I wanted to have you back. And you didn't stop doing your addictions work when you finished your study for the purposes of the journal. You have continued and are in another setting now, which gives you even more data and information about the problem with addiction. So, so how did you even come to do this?
Well, how did I come to do that study? I think what happened was I just was in this, it was an inpatient program, and I was learning things that I was surprised at when I was working in the program. One is when I was in that particular program, there were people that had severe problems, and I had pictured these people who were with the worst types of addictions. A lot of them were homeless with very severe medical problems. I had pictured that they would not have much, anybody out there, any family there. And I started noticing that they had very close relationships, particularly with their mother or their parents. And so, you know, I just started thinking, well, that's interesting. They end up in this situation. I had kind of thought of the people with these kind of problems as not having anybody, and it looked to me like they almost had too much people taking care of them, and they were adults. And I started thinking about what is the connection between having this level of a problem and yet at the same time having, particularly a lot with their mother or some kind of caretaker, this very intense relationship with somebody else in their life. And I just started thinking about that and noticing that that a lot of the clients there had difficulty staying off of drugs and alcohol. They were coming back into treatment pretty frequently.
Well, you're using the word too much, almost like it's too much. And how do you define too much? What was going on that you observed that you, I'm going to use the word smelled something different. Mm-hmm. You say, hey, this is, at a cellular level, a gong goes off in your head and you say, I'm surprised by this.
Well, like, a mother who, they were adult, maybe they had a child or two, but their mother was taking care of them. You know, they were 30 years, the average age there was like 35, something like that. And their mother had been taking care of them for a long time, was even taking care of their child, was helping to raise their child, was, you know, sometimes might, in some ways, well, regardless of whatever they did, the parent was kind of putting up with them. A lot of times the parent would come bring them to the program, so they didn't have to work. You know, they didn't really have to be real responsible in ways. So too much, I would say, almost love them too much, taking care of them too much for somebody that's an adult. For example, after I did the study, I was following up on people, and there was a person that had a long history of heroin addiction. And her mother ended up bringing her into the program, and she had some medical problems. I think we even had to take her to the hospital. She came back again. But I did a few follow-ups with her, and a year later, she was not using any drugs or alcohol. And I talked with her, and I talked with her mother. And when I talked with the mother, because it was telephone calls that I did as follow-up, I said, what happened that this time was different? Because this was the longest amount of time that this that her daughter had been off of drugs. And the mother said that, well, finally she got so fed up, she found her daughter using a needle in front of her little girl. And the mother of the addict said that this was it. And she said, I put her out on the street right then and there, and she was not going to live with me. I had to make a decision. Was I going to take care of my daughter, or was I going to take care of her little girl? And I felt like my responsibility was to take care of the little girl. And so the mother had been doing an awful lot, but I think she ended up drawing a line. I forget what your question was. I started getting into this example, but I thought by drawing a line, she wasn't going to keep doing this for her daughter. The daughter ended up functioning better. A year later, she was living apart from her mother. She was still having contact with her mother.
But it's such a scary, risky thing for a mother to do, because this kid is going to go, and particularly with a female, go out on the street and, quote, have to fend for herself, and the street is risky.
Right. And in fact, now you're helping me remember this story, because this was a number of years ago. And the mother said, I put her out, but she came back and said, take me to treatment. And so the mother said, I took her, I dropped her to treatment. I didn't even walk in the program with her. I dropped her off into your treatment program. Then the counselor called and said she had to go in the hospital because she had some kind of medical problem. And she said, I checked with her, but I didn't take her back in. And she went back to the treatment and finished the treatment. So yeah, it's the woman, it was a very serious thing. But, you know, I guess, I think by coming to a point by drawing a line, I mean, I think the line got, it was, she took too long to draw that line, but that was in some ways useful for that daughter. She ended up doing
okay. Oh, sounds like it was useful for the whole system.
The whole system, but it is a risk. I think that's, I believe that's why it's not that easy situation. If you have a child or adult child who has a drug or alcohol addiction that appears totally incapable and like they would die if you didn't take care of them, and you care about that person, you're liable to keep taking care of them. It's hard, I think, for a person to do anything different, particularly since my guess is that's what they've been doing all along.
Well, this is not the population then that they've gone, I mean, usually by the time a person gets addicted, they've stolen from your, you know, their relatives. They've done all sorts of things to get money for the heroin. You know, fenced the family, whatever it is, taken the family rent, whatever. And you would predict that long before they get to you, they would be cut off. That somebody would say, but they don't.
That's what was surprising.
I hear that.
And that's now some kind of them might be homeless, but they're still seeing their mother every day. You know, they're homeless. They can't spend the night, but they're still talking to them or having contact with them every day. In that particular program I worked, there was a percentage of the people who were, somebody had put them out because they were fed up, so they didn't have a place to go. So that's part of why they went to that program, because they knew they could get a place to stay in addition to the treatment.
Well, have you found this phenomenon to be consistent since the study as well with other segments of the heroin population, or is that something unique to the research population that you were seeing?
About the relationship with them?
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm working in a program with people that don't have that severe a problem. There's a small percentage of people that come in my program now that have had a severe problem, and then they're managing it a little bit better, because my program is just not that intense. It's an outpatient, it's not that tense a program. And there's a lot of things that do seem very similar in terms of this close connection with their mother, and how the stories about how, I mean, in my mind, in some ways, the mother contributed to the problem. In the client's mind, they would say, you know, my mother just loved me so much that she was going to give me that money to give me the drugs because she didn't want to see me sick. I mean, that's another view of it, and that's probably accurate too. But so the people that I'm seeing with that level of problem, yeah, it's a similar there's a similarity.
You know, in the literature of alcoholism, they talk about codependency, but I don't think I've ever seen it in the literature of addictions. But you're suggesting the possibility that it is a kind of a reciprocity here. That there's a reciprocal function here, that you'd almost have to run a hypothesis that the addicted family member serves a function for the other. And what is the nature of that function?
Well, the way I'm thinking about a person that has a severe drug or alcohol problem, there's probably everybody in the family contributes to it in some level or another. But that's what I would be thinking. That's not easy to see because I don't see the whole family. But I could see a little bit of it when I worked in an inpatient program where the family might bring the person in. Here's an example of a number of times a family member who brought the person in would say, I want to leave money for the person, for the person that's addicted, is that okay? Well, that's not okay. If somebody's totally addicted and they're going to stop using drugs, and it was in an area where you could easily buy a drug, and I would think of that as that's probably what they had been doing all along, giving them money for, they would be saying, for cigarettes or something like that. And I would say, please get the, buy the cigarettes or buy the food, whatever you want them to have. But, you know, I think people contribute in ways that they think they're helping the person, but they don't see it as in some ways contributing to the problem.
We had a young man in our family who was quite addicted, and he'd go to his grandmother, who was just a little bit around the bend, and he'd say, Granny, I'm going to a wedding this weekend, and I need $350 for a new pair of shoes. And darn if she wouldn't give it to him, because she wanted him to look good at the wedding. <you know? laughs> So it doesn't have to be a mother. It can be other family members, some willing soul who really, there's some attachment that is intense and does not want to see the other suffer in any way.
Counselors too. Yeah,
true.
I've seen that a lot.
Yeah. So that was one of the surprise findings then of your study of how you were viewing it at the time. And what other things then did you learn as you went through this research process?
That's a good question. Well, I guess the biggest thing is I was trying to figure out, is treatment helpful? What about treatment is helpful? And one of the biggest things is it's not that easy to see. There's no real one answer or what you can do, and it's certainly not treatment that's helpful. I mean, it's certainly not treatment that cures a person. I'm thinking of it now as a resource a person can use, and maybe it can help point them in a little better direction. But the way I think about it is, if a person has a drug or alcohol problem, you can't count on treatment as taking care of the problem.
Which is part of why you get the revolving door.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because that's just a resource a person can use. If a person's decided that they really want to stop using a drug or an alcohol, that's a resource that they can use to talk over, or a detox, or some kind of support group, or thoughts about jobs or whatever. But I just think it's like anything you want to change in yourself. It's just not that easy. It's very hard work, and you use a lot of resources to help move you forward.
If a person were severely addicted and listening to this show and have this quiet little voice in the side that says, you know, I think I'm tired of this and I'd like to get off, what would you suggest that they do? I'm asking this because it has to do with how would you even know the resources?
Mm-hmm.
How would you pay for it? What's out there? Now, you're from Baltimore, so I don't expect you to know the regional stuff. So I'm speaking more broadly about, I'll call it guidelines for
what's
good
the first,
guidelines for the search.
What's the first step?
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to give you probably a non-traditional answer because I'm working from Bowen theory. But one thing would be to ask yourself, am I physically dependent on this drug or alcohol? Because if you're physically dependent on it, then the first step would be to figure out a way to get a detox. So it would be a kind of somebody to help you medically.
Now, how would you know if you're physically dependent?
You
because you can
would,
play. In other words, there's a certain amount of head trips that mm-hmm. people play with themselves to get in this condition in the first place.
Well, if when you stop, you would know if you're physically dependent because when you stop using something, you're getting sick.
Okay.
When you stop using the like heroin or alcohol, you're getting sick.
That's not the flu. It's not something you ate. It's the heroin or the drug.
It might feel like the flu, but
yeah.
But cocaine, you wouldn't feel that way. But if it's a drug that you notice you stop using 24 hours later, you're really feeling ill, then you would want to get some medical assistance. It's probably not going to kill you if you go through to stop using heroin cold turkey. But if you're really physically dependent on alcohol, it could kill you. It can be a very serious withdrawal. So that would be the first thing to think about. You know, if you're getting sick, if you really just can't stop because you're getting sick, then you would want to get some medical detox. And but if it's not a matter of that, I would suggest calling the family center. I think that it's useful just to be able to talk to somebody that's calm, not overly focused on the drug or alcohol, but just can talk to you about what's going on to help you think through what are the steps you want to take to move yourself forward. So that's somebody that's motivated for themselves.
Well, in the program where you did the research, I think you were referring to Medicaid as apparently at the inpatient level. Medicaid mm-hmm. was paying for many of these people, was it private private fees, or how does that work?
The particular program that I was working in, medical assistance was paying for most of the people, and it was, I forget the exact term, it was like a rehab. It wasn't in a hospital setting, but it was, people could live there. They got room and board, and they got the treatment. Medicaid was actually paying for the treatment, and then they were making it, the room and board, available for those people. Originally, it had been a grant, but then mostly they were operating from getting Medicaid funding. Now, where I work now, we have a grant, and that's of course in Baltimore County, but we have a grant, we take different kinds of insurance, we can do sliding fee because of the grant, and some people pay our full fee.
As out of pocket.
Out of pocket, If they don't have insurance and they make above a certain income, then they pay our full fee. But I would imagine there's places wherever people are listening here that have grant-type programs if they don't have insurance. But if they have insurance, they can just call their insurance company to find out where they could get a detox, for example, or if they think they need an inpatient kind of program, where they could get an inpatient kind of program.
Somewhere in the literature, and I think it was in your study, but maybe not, there was something about one of the variables, if we're thinking about family variables, was that people who had an intact family up to the age of 6 seemed to do better than those who didn't. Do you have any way of thinking about that one?
One of the studies that I reported on?
Yeah, well, I've read it somewhere.
Okay.
And I didn't. Okay. I was trying to figure out, well, what about up to the age of 6 would make any difference at all?
No, I know that when I looked at that, when I kind of reviewed about 100 some people who were heroin addicts that came in the program, and I asked them who they were raised by, both parents, a single parent, foster care, family members that weren't their parents. I didn't find a significant difference in who was raising them, and did they recover or did they continue to relapse? I didn't find a significant difference there, but I do remember seeing one. I think it was, I don't think it was a lot of studies that was focused on that, but anyway, my way of thinking about it is that I do notice that, and this isn't in a study in any way, that people who have that are raised by two parents that have a stable kind of home. Doesn't necessarily mean to be two parents, but maybe the same parent or the same people that are raising them. It looks like their functioning is a little bit better than the people that I've seen who have been raised by various people, been out on the street different times. So my thinking would be
sort of an index of chaos, how much chaos they've experienced.
Yeah, that's
early
the way
on,
I would think about it. Not so much who it was that raised them, but was it consistent and stable? To me, it looks like where it wasn't consistent and stable, those are the people that have more difficulties overall in life functioning. So it wouldn't surprise me if you took a really big study that the people that had a more chaotic life when they were young, I don't know why till six, you know, but their early years, I would think those people...
Well, as with so many studies, it might have been something arbitrary.
Yes.
You know, that
uh-huh.
somebody who was doing the research had a hypothesis uh-huh. about... Probably it comes out of Freudian theory.
Well, that's what I was thinking about.
You know, give me a kid until he's six and he's mine, or what? Uh-huh. There's some expression about it.
Uh-huh.
It might have come out of Freudian theory, and it may or may not have validity, as with all ideas. But I just was wondering if you'd found anything similar. And I think you're pointing out something important here. It's not that there was a, quote, a marriage per se, mm-hmm. but it's an index of how much chaos or how much stability. It's just kind of an indicator.
Yeah, and it might not be that the problem surfaces in the drug. It might be it surfaces in other ways, but it looks like the people that are brought up in those chaotic environments, the ones that I see have more of a problem in terms of their independent functioning or even their functioning in a counseling setting, knowing to show up for appointments and paying for fees and, you know, how to manage themselves in that kind of a setting.
Well, let's shift gears just a little bit, because you saw heroin addicts early on in a, I'm assuming it's a voluntary setting.
Yes.
Where people everybody
because
who came.
They wanted to come.
Right.
I mean, maybe their parents.
But you're in a different setting now.
Yes.
And what difference does that make?
I'm in a setting where most of the people I'm seeing are court ordered for treatment. Makes a big difference in that they're all saying they don't have a problem. Even though there's not a consensus of opinion that if you've had three DWIs for alcohol, not everybody there believes that means you have an alcohol problem.
Okay.
But anyway, it's an outpatient setting. It's a lot of people are there for alcohol, marijuana, cocaine, and I'm not seeing as many people there for heroin. And it's mostly people court-ordered, or maybe they've lost their driving license because of DWIs, and the MVA is requiring they get treatment. And what difference does that make?
Well, one thing, you certainly start in a different place.
You really start a different way. The difference is that I have to readjust how I communicate to the person, because they do feel they have a problem. It's the law. It's a legal problem.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's a good index, uh-huh. though, of the amount of projection that goes on. It's not my fault.
Yeah.
I didn't do
uh-huh.
anything.
Yeah.
It was that cop that stopped me. I mean, I'd only had, you know, what, six beers and whatever. I can handle that.
I've learned a lot. I've learned that some people don't think six beers is a lot to drink.
Oh, okay.
But what difference does it make in terms of, what, the outcome of treatment, do you mean? Or?
Well, it makes a difference from the standpoint of where you as a therapist are beginning with the client. But it also...
Uh-huh.
From the standpoint of the person entering the treatment program, it makes a difference to them. I mean, they are in a different place than the people who already are saying, man, I am really out, uh-huh. kind of out in the weeds here. It's time to move myself in. And what goes into that shift where you can do some productive work?
Well, one of the things that I haven't said is that I feel like with both populations, I've been seeing people that have some severe problems. Maybe it's not an alcohol or drug, but severe legal problems. And they're not if they're not motivated or they're really having problems in functioning, I feel like all I can offer is just trying to think alongside of them, try to talk with them, find out, you know, well, what is it that bothers you? If they, you know, a lot of times they're saying it's the fact they got to be in treatment when they're court ordered, and just going with that. In other words, just trying to communicate with the person where they are and trying to help them think through what are the next steps they want to do. So I don't know that I'm actually operating differently, although
I hear you in that statement as you not taking the problem on as if it's your problem, of letting the person figure out what do they need to do to get their life on course. It's critical to something here.
Yes. Now, at the same time, the people that are court ordered, I'm not telling them what they have to do with their life, but I do have to say what I'm going to do if they don't do certain things. In terms of if they're court ordered for treatment, they've got to tell their probation officer or the judge or somebody they've completed treatment. So I do say, well, if you want a complete treatment, if you want a letter of treatment completion, I define that means you've got to show up, you've got to pay your fees, you've got to, when I do random urine or drug or alcohol tests, be negative, you've got to stop drinking or using drugs for at least a couple months. That's my particular criteria. So I have some definitions for the completion letter, but you know, they don't have to get the completion letter, or they, you know, they could go to other programs or work with other people. So on one hand, I'm just trying to work with them where they're at, but I do have criteria for that usually they're kind of motivated to meet if they want a completion letter.
Well, these criteria are not your personal criteria, are
they?
No,
they're in line with...
mandated by your program, or...?
Well, it's in line with the program isn't quite as clear. Well, the program isn't quite as clear as I am. Because basically my program is abstinence, you have to abstain, you have the program...
You just spell it out so people can hear it better.
I spell it out very clearly because, usually people will do it when I've spelled it out pretty clearly. When they come in, they see things in writing, they sign what they're supposed to do, but it isn't always that clear. And
it's helpful to know about these things because I think people... society spends an awful lot of money trying to be useful to people who do have problems they're trying to deal mm-hmm. with. And to have you come and help us understand some of the details of this, I think has been terribly useful. And appreciate you coming not once but twice to mm-hmm. the show. So I want to thank you for being here and hope you'll come again some other time to fill us in on what you've been working on. So
well,
thank you
so
very much,
for having me.
Yeah, thank you.
If
you'd like additional information about our topic, please contact the Bowen Center for the Family at 202-965-4400 or on the web at www.thebowencenter.org. I'm Dr. Roberta Holt. I want to thank you for watching, and your family does matter.